Thank you, John. Thank you all for coming. It's indeed an honor to be here today in a renowned location. I'll give you 25 years of Afghanistan's history in about 27 minutes. So it's going to be a lot of shoveling of data your way, and then I hope to open it up for questions. But a bit of context is important, at least on how I got to the region. I moved to New Delhi, India in 1988 with Time magazine, and the bureau covers six countries of South Asia. And at the time, India was essentially asleep economically and financially. It wasn't much of a story for journalists, so most of our time was spent in Pakistan and Afghanistan, learning the ins and outs of that place. And again, one thing to remember, this is pre-computer. We did everything by telex. The beauty of this location, and there are many, is that 8,000 miles away, New York couldn't find you most of the time. And that's where the offices were, and 9 hours time difference. So we use that to the best advantage. And since the region was changing at the time, Cold War was still alive and well, and the Soviets had agreed under Gorbachev to remove their army from Afghanistan, this was the time that we could now change from backpacking in as journalists through Pakistan across the Khyber Pass into Afghanistan with the Mujahideen. They were now going to give visas for journalists, and that was essential for me to sort of turn the page of the previous 8 years of coverage. The Soviet Army, as many of you remember, went in 1979, and with the Saudi, Egyptian, and a score of other allies, the United States decided to stick it to the Soviet Union, for lack of a better expression, for the war in Vietnam, which that whole tit-for-tat mentality still was playing itself out. As photographers, you had to work with a writer in a collective fashion, and the learning curve was quite steep. So we had in 1984, remember the Golden Temple was attacked in the Sikh area. Kashmir was beginning to fester as a low intensity conflict. The civil war in Sri Lanka was on our heads. Bangladesh and Pakistan had martial law, which provided a different environment to work in, particularly with censorship and restrictions on the media. And then, of course, you had the Soviet army that was planted in Afghanistan. So at this point in time, in 1988, the Russians, rather than call them Soviets, had killed 1 million Afghans in 9 years. That's a lot of killing, carpet bombing, and execution. There was no love lost between the two, and most Afghans, no matter who they were with, were very happy to see the Russians leave. But what happened in this interim between 1988 and 1992, when the Mujahideen took power, is that the United States took its eyes once off the ball. And we closed our embassy in 1989 and didn't reopen until December 17th, 2001. So with all of the help that the Muslim countries provided for jihad, a lot of the jihadis stayed in Afghanistan, and out comes Al-Qaeda. So with that, I bookend this series of photographs with 2013. The US military starts their withdrawal, and it starts with the Soviet withdrawal in 1988. Let's see if we can. This is a picture of an Afghan soldier handing a flag of friendship to the retreating or departing Soviet officer. And again, it's rather ambiguous here. After 1 million people have been killed, how can a flag of friendship be handed off? So in 1989, in the Battle of Jalalabad in the eastern part of the country, the CIA and the Pakistani intelligence agency tried to establish a foothold in Nangarhar province. And this is the Battle of Jalalabad in 1989 of March. And one thing to keep in mind again are the Arab fighters. Bin Laden is about 2 miles from this picture. We didn't want to have much to do as journalists with the Arab fighters. They didn't take kindly to the camera, nor did they want to be interviewed. But this gives you an idea of the ragtag nature of the jihadi groups that the United States, Pakistan, and all of the Arab countries were funding. And this is an example of carpet bombing. You can see the civilians leaving the Battle of Jalalabad, and you can see the string of smoke as a plane dives overhead and just drops indiscriminately. They were obviously using the road as a guide and thankfully missed. I was cooling my feet literally in this mountain stream, boots off, when this happened, so it doesn't leave you much time to put your socks on. So this gives you an idea of the military academy in Kabul, which is the equivalent of their West Point. You can see the discipline, the esprit de corps, and the serious training that went on in Kabul in 1989 with the Afghan Communist Party being a very force to reckon with. You can see the ragtag nature of the jihadis, and then back contrast that with the military academy in Kabul. Eventually, all of these students either defected to the Mujahideen or left the country because they were targets. Once the Mujahideen came into power, this is from 1990. So in 1991, the Battle of Jalalabad had been a failure in 89. This is the Battle of Host Province. And off here on the right is Pakistan, so geography plays a big role. This is the border area that was the main funneling area for the CIA and the ISI, Pakistan's intelligence agency, to support the group of Jalaluddin Haqqani, and he was successful in taking Host Province in 1991. And this, you can see how easily country boys, what do they do with an airplane? They basically play with it. But these are the people that control the training camps that Jalaluddin Haqqani, this is the father of global jihad, and he was from this area. The Zadran tribe is quite prominent along the border. It straddles Pakistan and Afghanistan and in tribal territory. So he was not only a very good smuggler, but he was also a very convincing jihadi fighter. And his family is still around today. His sons have been killed, as well as two of them are still alive. But he agreed to see me, among a few other journalists, because in 1990, when this picture was taken, word started to come out that Pakistan was training Indian Kashmiri militants in camps in Afghanistan, and he was the host. He was also the host for bin Laden. Bin Laden had tried to set up camps in different parts of Afghanistan, but he and Haqqani got along famously. And he was the first person really to go to the Arab during Hajj and raise money from rich, wealthy princes and Arabs during his trips to Mecca. And this is what he was concerned with, is spreading jihad. He didn't care that I was an American. He had no problem with that at all. In fact, he offered us lunch, tea, as a good host. But he's still alive, and he's rumored to be in a nursing home in Karachi. But you can see that the CIA has had trouble dealing with this because he's an asset for Pakistan. This is the backside of a Haqqani camp built by construction equipment brought in by Osama bin Laden. You can see captured Russian tanks here on the left and in the center. And this is also one of the camps along the Pakistani border that Bill Clinton sent cruise missiles into to try to, when the first embassy was attacked in Sudan, when the rockets went into that as well. But this is a picture from 1990. Not really offered to us, but if you're quick and pre-focused your camera, you could take these pictures. But this, you can see how well concealed it is. And these are two Al-Qaeda instructors in the front training four Afghans in the back in the same area, done during the same or second trip that I made, two trips into these camps looking for different fighters. But this is the area that's still active today for training. And the Pakistanis refuse to dismantle it, and this is the area where drones are coming in. So one of the more interesting ethnic groups that was involved in these training camps are the Chinese Muslims, the Uyghurs. They're still active today in these camps being trained. And the beauty of having a reporter along who spoke fluent Mandarin was that he totally freaked them out and went up to them and said, "Watch what happens when I speak Mandarin to them." And their excuse, they're a little embarrassed here if you can judge body language, but they couldn't escape. They said, well, we're only here for the weekend because our parents have a Chinese restaurant in Lahore. Well, they must still be functioning with a restaurant in Lahore because the Uyghurs are still there being trained along the Afghan-Pakistan border. And it's a big bone of contention with the Chinese, obviously. So back to daily life in downtown Kabul, which was what I tried to capture on numerous trips. Obviously, this picture didn't require a visa. We could just walk across the border. But here we had to fly in, and we had a foreign ministry guide with us at all times, obviously watching us. But this is a picnic on Friday, their holy day, in the Mughal Gardens, a 16th century beauty gem of theirs, sort of similar to a Central Park. And this is a traditional folk dance. The women are not there, they're off to the side, and there's a harmonium and a tabla player off on the right. But this is a dance called the Atan. And these are almond trees in a beautiful garden. So in 1992, this was 1991, 1992 in March, it became pretty evident that the government would soon fall. The jihad groups were coming closer and closer to Kabul. They were shelling the city every day. And here is essentially a young newspaper hawker, as they're called, trying to sell the one government newspaper. There was one radio station and one television station. There was no free press. This was all done by the Afghan Communist Party. And you can see the person in the background. It's important to quickly get the content of this. He's the only literate person in the group reading the daily paper. And that's often how word was spread from the paper. Most people couldn't read in Afghanistan. And there's still an issue about literacy. But this is a great daily scene. And people were obviously curious because they knew the Mujahideen were getting closer and closer. In April 18th, 1992, we could sense, and I had the license by time and the support to stay on for a month or two in Afghanistan. And this is how you got to the very crucial meetings of all the jihadi leaders, minus the Pashtuns, the main ethnic group. But here, this is a good glimpse of inside Afghanistan. Afghanistan is essentially ethnic groups. It's not one country. It's 4 to 5 ethnic groups. And here you have, and you have to learn how to profile quickly from faces and beards and mustaches and eyes, noses. It's all very important. The person on the left is an Ismaili. They pay homage to the Aga Khan. Next to him is an Uzbek, General Dustum, and he had just defected as the Minister of Defense from the Kabul government to join the jihadi leaders. And in the middle, you have Ahmad Shah Massoud, who's a Tajik, Farsi-speaking. So you have more Persian in the middle and more Central Asian look to that left. And then you have the Uzbek, very much the bloodlines of Genghis Khan. And then you have the Persian, because it was once part of the Persian Empire, Afghanistan. So all of these faces and looks, without being able to speak the language, you had to be able to figure out who's who. And these were essentially the group that decided which intersections they were going to take in downtown Kabul, which ministries they were going to divide up amongst each other, and how they were going to go about it. And the people that were not there were the CIA's and the Pakistan's intelligence agency, warlord Gulbuddin Hekmatyar. He refused to join this. And that was the battle that soon led to the civil war, which lasted for 4 years. But this is essentially Ahmad Shah Massoud, who was later assassinated in 2001, the very charismatic leader, telling the journalists what they were going to do in 1 week's time. And on April 23rd, these are Uzbek fighters taking control of a very important intersection, keeping the Pashtuns out, backed by the Pakistanis and the CIA. Why the CIA continued to do this, back a group that was no longer liked or appreciated, but they pretty much gave the control to Pakistan, and underneath Pakistan, behind them, of course, were the Saudis. So victory lasted very short. This is April 23, 5-6 days after this meeting, north of the capital. And it's rare that you get to be informed so well in advance, but there are no newspapers and no radio, and there are no cell phones. So you pretty much have to go on your hunches. Interesting, you can see the no boots on the fellow on the left. These are fearless fighters, and their main rivals are ethnic Pashtuns. The Uzbeks and Pashtuns despise each other. It's a perfect matchup in a battle. Believe me, they use militias smartly. So 1993, this begins the internecine battles within the city and within the country in different provinces. This civilian caught in crossfire, downtown Kabul. The lines are about 800 to 1,000 yards apart. And a stray bullet, he was obviously out to pick up vegetables or milk at the market since they don't have electricity or refrigeration. And this gives you an average daily scene in downtown Kabul in 1993. Basically stoned, chaotic tank drivers on a joyride. You can see what they did with one of their landmark. It's used for tank shells. And they were continually rocketing the city. Gulbuddin Hekmatyar was ruthless in not taking power. It had been divided up between he and Ahmad Shah Massoud. He refused to come into power in 1992, and he continued to rocket the city, killing about 30,000 civilians, which is a lot. Similar to what's going on in Ukraine. This gives you an idea of what it's like as from the civilian side. Again, in urban warfare, civilians have to flee quickly if the artillery battle, which is right down in their neighborhood in downtown Kabul. But what's interesting is when I scanned this picture in as a slide, I didn't notice it until we scanned it properly on a high-def scanner. What do you take if you have to flee within 30 seconds? You take a chicken, a teacup, and a bicycle. This is all one family. This is the mother, daughter-in-law, and a bag of food. So there's no men here of fighting age. They're off fighting in the different ethnic factions. But in a few days, they were able to return home. But this, the civilians, again, are the meat and the sandwich and the ones who suffer the most. So Gulbuddin Hekmatyar controlled the route in from Pakistan for fuel and food. And this is what happens when he decided to cut the road across the Khyber Pass. There was no gasoline. So there was no way for people to get to work. And you can count, I've stopped at 23, 24 people in this car. It's a Russian Volga as a taxi. But there were no buses running. And the gasoline was often watered down and to be bought on the black market, including the gasoline we used as journalists. A family here whose main breadwinner, the husband, had been killed during the Mujahideen days, squatting in an apartment in downtown Kabul. It's very rare for women to agree to have their pictures taken in the Islamic world, but she was strong enough and felt confident enough to state her case. You can see she's got six kids and has a ration ticket worth about $15 a month. Downtown Kabul, this is the main front line. It's been completely rebuilt now. In 1994, there's a lull in the fighting, and Al-Qaeda, the Pashtuns, and the Afghan opposition are down at the other end of this street, out of the effective range of rifle fire, and these are boys working for the government army. There's a truce, and it was the only time for us to get down to the main front line. But things turn very quickly. This is a group of four carrying away their fifth comrade. An argument had ensued during one of these lulls. We went downtown, a British reporter and I, to talk to the front line, what was going on. These are Kandaharis, by the way, from southern Afghanistan. Very much at battle on the front line in downtown Kabul. But another group came around the corner and started arguing with these four or five guys because they claimed this group had stolen their television set. Now, there's no power. Why argue over a television set? But the way they decide arguments there is right in front of us, they lowered the rifle and shot the guy in the stomach. So we took off upstairs to get out of the way. And you can see this blurred taxi in the lower left hand, the yellow. They wanted the taxi to take their colleague away to the hospital. The fellow had three or four bullets in him. He was basically dead. But smartly, and this is one of the things you have to do as a journalist in a conflict zone, is find a driver who's very smart. He had a kill switch underneath his dashboard. So he went down, and they demanded, you can see the fellow up in the upper left there saying, where is the driver? So he went down and said he tried to turn the car over, and of course it would whine and whine, but it would never spark. He had flipped the switch. So off they threw this guy into a wheelbarrow and took him away, but we saved our car. Important person. So the Sunni-Shia thing now comes into the picture, and it's still alive and well with us today in Iraq and Syria. I came across this. I still haven't found the journalist I was walking around with this day in Western Kabul. I came across a clinic, went out back to a cemetery, and found all these bodies of Shia militants, or a militia unit of one of the controllers of Western Kabul, had been either executed there or executed somewhere else and dumped here behind a clinic. And their shoes are still there. This body, I think, had been turned over. It was in March. He'd been on his stomach. Obviously, somebody had flipped him over. Very well preserved. The dogs hadn't gotten there yet, which is allows a photographer to take a civilized picture. But today, this area is completely rebuilt, and I tried to find it in 2013. I couldn't find this spot, and it would take it probably a military base right now. But eight or nine Shia were killed, and over 800 have been killed in the upper left neighborhood in February of 1993, and it was done by the Sunni government. For control over Western Kabul. So this whole ethnic battle continues on, but it was rare to get evidence of it. So we move from 1993 to 1996. This is the takeover of Kabul by the Taliban in September of 1996. You can see the rudimentary equipment they have. This is a Chinese Jeep firing a 107-millimeter rocket at the retreating forces of Ahmad Shah Massoud as they're forced out of Kabul in September of 1996. The Taliban came up from the southwest of Afghanistan and gradually got their control of the capital, and this is part of it. So in October of 1996, with no radio, no television, no broadcast possibility, no newspapers, this is a mullah from Kandahar reading the citizens of Kabul, basically the riot act. Now that they have 100% control of Afghanistan, they say, this is what he was telling them that they had to do. They had to pray five times a day, shops will be closed, no movie theaters, no music, no loud weddings. Women must be covered and accompanied when they leave the house. Schools will be closed, women will no longer be educated. And this is where it was read out. Very rudimentary, but extremely interesting part of Afghan history to be there, because the Civil War was technically over, except this wasn't going to last. Bin Laden had already left for Sudan, and I believe he was on his way back to Afghanistan. This is what the Taliban did to a science lab at a university, basically destroyed it, and it set the country back years. So in 1997, up in the northeastern part of the country, northwestern part of Mazar-i-Sharif, which is a very famous Silk Road capital of Balkh province, there's a big shrine there. The Taliban had cut a deal with the Uzbeks, again, their primary enemies, ethnic enemies. This is the Taliban Minister of the Interior cutting a deal with a general who had defected from the Air Force to take control of Mazar-i-Sharif. Now, this was a truce which was very tenuous, and I was part of a group of journalists that got in there before they closed the airport in Mazar-i-Sharif, took a flight in from Pakistan, but it's near the Iranian-Uzbek border. So it's a very interesting part of the history here, and you can see the different facial features. The Taliban have thick beards, and the Uzbeks have no facial hair. So they're easily spotted. And the people on the left, the Uzbeks, are very curious about Pashtuns because they're bitter enemies. And this is the first time that they had really come together. And you can see the look of confusion and wonderment on the faces of the people on the left. But it lasted for 36 hours, this truce. And by some grace of God, I happened to be there when everything fell apart. And you watch this fellow. The locals lured in the Taliban, about 30 of them with two tanks behind me. And somebody walked across the street, went into this where the spark is, and opened fire on the Taliban. And this poor sap walked up there with his machine gun and thought that he could take him out. You can see the brass casings in the middle of the picture. But look at this pile of dung. You'll see the power of being hit. He's thrown all the way back. This is the same pile of dung, thrown back about 10, 12 feet. So they were all on the rooftops firing down at them. You can see how their trucks were, door was open. Everybody is standing here in shock. And in about 18 hours, 800 people were killed. They were all, the whole entire contingency of the Taliban coming in were killed, except for the minister. He got out. This began the battle about 6 o'clock in the afternoon. We had to take refuge in a clinic, couldn't get out, but everyone is there, goes down. This fellow walks away, not happy. His friend fired an RPG into that doorway and then picked up his buddy and took him away. And this is what it looked like the day after, all dead. They don't speak a common language in that area. Nobody speaks Pashto. They all speak Uzbek. So they were targets. They had nowhere to run. This is the Red Cross taking the bodies away. So in 1997, the Taliban were very angry. And they went back the next year and killed 2,000 locals. So revenge is a very important word in this area, throughout the Middle East, for that matter. So we moved to 2001. This is 1997. At this point, the Taliban and Al-Qaeda have 90% control of Afghanistan, and this is a refugee camp up in near Mazar-i-Sharif, between Mazar-i-Sharif and Herat on the Iranian border. The Taliban refused to let UN aid in, food, shelter materials, and medicine. This is a baby that died in February of 2001 from exposure, and it's being prepared for burial. So we're 9 months into 2001 is September 11th. This is the second month, so September 11th is 7 months away. The Taliban are not happy. They were about to blow up the Buddhas. But this is the funeral procession, taking that little child to the grave. The father is on the left, and it's traditional for the men to carry for about 200 yards or however they have to walk and then pass the body along. So in May of 2001, with the same Mandarin-speaking journalist, I went up to see Ahmad Shah Massoud, who had the last 10% of Afghanistan in Badakhshan province. This is Massoud coming out to speak to some of the elders. He was also the leader of that area, but he was the last remaining force to keep Al-Qaeda and the Taliban from taking over the last 10% of the country. And the journalist I was with had known Ahmad Shah Massoud for about 10 years, so it was a very interesting and familiar, easy interview to go through, but he had mentioned to us, now this is 4 months away from 9/11, that something was going on in Kandahar. His spies told him that bin Laden was up to something. Whatever new information he had, he didn't reveal to us, but sure enough, 4 months later, on September 9th, two Arab journalists, they were Al-Qaeda posing as journalists, interviewed him, and one of the two cameras that was aimed at him was packed full of explosives, and they killed him on September 9th. This was all part of the plan, and he was killed in that building right behind him. So at that point in time, on September 9th, Al-Qaeda and Taliban had 100% control of Afghanistan. Interesting point, quickly forgotten by September 11th. But had September 11th been foiled, who knows what the Americans would have done about Al-Qaeda and Taliban having 100% control of Afghanistan. You can debate, this is the right environment for debates of that nature or discussion, but who knows what people would say about whether or not we were determined enough to go into Afghanistan to take them out. Probably not, my opinion. So we moved to November of 2001, and the Taliban were still in control of this city, their main capital. They didn't recognize Kabul as their capital. We were given, 22 of us were given visas to come in. And this is Kandahar City after about 10 days of aerial bombardment. In October, the United States Air Force, the French, and the British started bombing Taliban and Al-Qaeda targets. And this is the expression of disbelief of seeing Western journalists and Pakistanis here in downtown Kandahar. These are all Taliban. Some of them are more academic rather than fighters, more spiritual. But they didn't really like us being there. They had already been suffering from a lot of degradation from a very effective bombing. So this is the cover of the book. This is a shepherd. You can see it's a very interesting photograph, one that I found quite timeless, judging not only from his dress, but of the terrain. This is a shepherd calling in his children to bring in the goats and the sheep after this village had been leveled by French and American Air Force because they believed Taliban and Al-Qaeda had taken refuge outside of Kandahar City. We got there a few days later. It was interesting to be given permission by the Taliban to see this, what they called a human rights violation. Lord knows who was there. But if you're taking refuge from Kandahar City, it would be the right place to go to. But the thing is, there normally isn't any lighting there. They found lanterns and some kind of generators from the sky, so they bombed the place. 17 people were known to have been buried, possibly more. But this gives you an indication of what both sides can offer journalists, and you have to take these opportunities to go out and visit. So this is December of 2001. These are four Pakistani Taliban who were captured outside of Kabul. They were trained in a madrasa in Punjab province. They admitted to being part of a very Sunni chauvinist group, and they are captured by the Tajiks inside Kabul and eventually traded back to Pakistan. This is December of 2001. So in Tora Bora, some of you may remember this location in eastern Afghanistan. When bin Laden left and went over the mountains into Afghanistan, he left behind 12 to 15 Arabs and Taliban to protect his rear, his withdrawal. And after they surrendered, they were brought out for the media. This is a Yemeni or a Saudi, and probably one of the first visitors to Guantanamo. But eventually they were all traded to the Americans for cash. That's what you do with prisoners in that part of the world. So in 2002, this is the 10th Mountain Division in a big battle in central Afghanistan to chase Al-Qaeda and the Taliban away from Kabul in a battle called Anaconda. There's a very interesting book called Not a Good Day to Die, but it describes the difficulty that Americans and Canadian soldiers had at 5,500 feet carrying 80, 90, 100 pound packs at this altitude, and the dehydration and the difficulty they had just in trying to chase out the enemy. This is a dead Taliban underneath a blanket. And when I scan the picture in, this is a digital now, we go from film to digital. I noticed there were two sets of rubber gloves. And what the heck were those doing there? And I noticed that the left hand had been fingerprinted. Strange. So a forensic team had already been through. March. One of the things I wanted to do in the book was to bring in the countries that surround Afghanistan. And these are Afghan Taliban in Baluchistan, Pakistan, where they would take refuge during the winter. And then once the snows would thaw, they would cross the border and go back into Afghanistan. Pakistan continues to deny this, that they were giving refuge to the Taliban. But here, even though I'm dressed in a shalwar kameez, they knew who I was. And I knew where to stand when they came out of the mosque on a Friday. 2008, again back to very interesting geography in Nuristan province in the Hindu Kush. You can see why on earth the Americans would have a base at the bottom of this valley, sitting ducks, if you know of any of the pictures from the British occupation of Afghanistan in the 19th century. They were always down at the bottom of a valley, and these turbaned fighters with their long muskets were shooting down at the British. Yet we didn't learn from the past. This is, these are three 10th Mountain Division fellows who were on a mission to resupply a base way up at the top here. This is the Black Hawk rescue helicopter. They were ambushed and caught some shrapnel and rock in their faces. This base was overrun 2 years later. 8 Americans were killed, 23 wounded, and basically gave it back to the Taliban. So some of the personalities were very interesting in Afghanistan. This is Zalmay Khalilzad, an Afghan-American. He's the ambassador to Afghanistan. He left the country when he was 15. Very smart, was an acolyte of the Kissinger neocons in Washington, went to Georgetown, extremely smart, very manipulative, a clever politician, and he was also the U.S. ambassador in Baghdad. This is gives you an indication of the security he has. DynCorp, which is the number two to Blackwater, protects the embassy people. This is in an airport, Kandahar Airport, that was built in the early 50s by the Americans, competing with the Russians. The Russians build the roads, we build the airports. And the fellow on the right has a very interesting profile. If many of have, if you've seen American Sniper, you can see how they're typecast. They're called trigger pullers. And they make a lot of money every day. So again, back to the terrain. Geography is incredibly important in Afghanistan. This is in Kunar province, a Marine coming up a hill at about 6,000-7,000 feet. It's the Kunar River in the Hindu Kush. Again, huffing and puffing, carrying 50, 60 pounds. And he's just to come up to the top of the outpost. Not in any combat danger. This is one of the few posts that's still remaining in Afghanistan. President Karzai at a press conference in 2009. Very interesting fellow. Here's two Afghan national policemen inviting me in to breakfast in the middle of nowhere in Ghazni province. But what I found interesting here, while I was waiting for a reporter to come out, he was talking to the district governor. This here is our legacy, in my view. You can see the brand new Ford pickup truck on the left, the British Hesco walls up here on the top, an Afghan flag, the top of a Chinese or a Russian Jeep, a broken chair, dirty socks, an unused traffic cone, more Hesco walls, and two fellows, hapless, they're the targets of the Taliban, inviting me in for breakfast. Very genuine, but the thing about the Ford pickup truck on the left, that we gave them 11 brand new Ford pickup trucks, but all the fuel is stolen by the time it leaves Kabul and goes out to the countryside. The fuel never arrives, the trucks are never used. The area is 80% controlled by the Taliban. So nobody goes out. It's a real problem in who they turn the country back to. It's an item for discussion still today. Again, the whole cross and clash of cultures here. 10th Mountain soldier, 10th Mountain Division meeting a village boy in Wardak province. Lord knows what's going on in their minds. Obviously some mistrust, but they do. Afghans essentially like the Americans when we first arrived. There was great appreciation for the Americans coming in and kicking out Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. But things went south soon after, when promises weren't met or projects delivered, and a lot of people get very emotional and wonder really what side to play, and they're obviously now thinking about, are the Taliban coming back, and it gets very complicated. But this is an image from 2009, about 2 hours outside of Kabul. So in 2009, I did a lot of embeds, which is one way to get around the country. You need the security and the transportation system of the military. These are Marines in southern Helmand province. It's 125 degrees. not great for patrolling, which also means that your plates on the back and the front are also 125 degrees. So this picture was in the New York Times, and I sent a quick thumbnail picture of it to the battalion commander, and the first sergeant got the email and said, thank you very much, very nice to see our men in the New York Times, but there's a bit of a backstory here. A word came out of the Pentagon from a regimental sergeant major that these men should be punished because they're out of uniform.
Who would that come from?
In the Pentagon? A sergeant major. I don't have his name. But you, do-rags. They're not supposed to be wearing do-rags, which is the only way you can keep sweat from pouring out. Because you go, as soon as you take a quart of water, you sweat it out. So he said, don't worry, nothing happened to them. But this gives you the idea of disconnect 8,500 miles apart, somebody sitting in an air-conditioned office telling Marines what to do about how to dress. Just a small little inside. No one would have known that in the caption because I didn't put that in. But back to, this is sea level in southern Helmand, big opium growing area. Marines only showed up with half a battalion, not a full battalion, couldn't do much. This was part of the surge in 2009. How effective it was is still under discussion. Back to 7,000, 8,000, 9,000 feet of the Hindu Kush in Kunar, which is where I went right after the desert. It just flattened me on an aerial assault. But this gives you an idea of the terrain. There's only one road leading into this region. And if you think you're going to get in there without being ambushed, you have another story. But Petraeus, General Petraeus and General McChrystal agreed to give up most of these small bases in this region. They just couldn't resupply on a regular basis. Back to sea level again, where the Marines were in Helmand province, a 16th century fort. A bomb disposal unit checking a farmer's fertilizer supply to make sure he's not making IEDs, the active ingredients being ammonium nitrate, ball bearings, diesel, and mix it in a big 5-gallon container and then bury it in the ground. It was determined that he was just a regular farmer. But there were a lot of irregular farmers out in southern Afghanistan. So in 2013, I was very surprised to get access to this drone taking off, but it's actually a very old technology. So this is not an armed drone, it's for reconnaissance. And you can see the ramp that it's sent off right here. It reaches 80 miles an hour by the time it leaves the ramp. And it stays up for 6 hours and has incredible optics. A very safe unit. If you're launching drones, you're not really in harm's way. It's very much part of the technology. Are drones liked? No, they're not. At least by the civilian side. So there's a big discussion on how effective they really are. You bomb one village, you lose 10, is one theory. And General McChrystal was not happy with that. But anyway, this is one way that technology works its way into conflict resolution. So the retrograde, this is what withdrawal is called by the logisticians. You can see this at Bagram Air Base. All of these MRAP vehicles, mine resistant, ambush protected, 15-ton vehicles, very nice, very useful in the countryside, well air conditioned, very protecting for the soldiers and Marines. But now they're being sent out. Some of them have shown up in police departments in California, much to the chagrin of the civilians. But what are you going to do with all these vehicles? They're $750,000 each. And here you can see the one Army soldier looking for stray bullets that they haven't fallen down into any crevasse that could possibly explode on the flight out. Most of them were taken to the Middle East, Germany, or sent back to the States. A very expensive operation. But this is Bagram Air Base in central Afghanistan. An interesting place to be, and one of the only places you could see equipment being collected. Downtown Kabul, a wedding hall. This is the new Kabul. You just remember the downtown Kabul of the rubble that I showed you earlier. This is a view of western Kabul where the civilians that, or the militants that I showed you that were killed somewhere out in this area. This is Kabul University. This is the Kabul River. This is a big road leading out west to the Darulaman Palace, where the Soviets had their Ministry of Defense. So these are all important landmarks to learn. And that civilian that was wounded, this was the front line at one point. It's all been reconstructed. And on my last day in Kabul, two suburban SUVs were blown up in a suicide attack, killing 6 Americans and 10 Afghans. Not a very happy situation. This is the actual withdrawal. This is about as close as you're going to see to soldiers actually leaving. Bagram Air Base, you can get an idea of how big it is. Now in 2001, Al-Qaeda had all of this area under control. They knew the opposition. Ahmad Shah Massoud's forces had the other side of the airport, but in the 13 years distance between that period, all this was, this is a brand new airstrip. You can see the C-130s. It would take a C-5A. All kinds of airplanes can come in here. These are soldiers leaving. These are soldiers coming in May of 2013 to finish their deployment. Essentially, these guys are going home. No weapons. They're coming in with weapons. But one thing I noticed is this nice little middle finger for my benefit. Something you don't see in a viewfinder. But he wanted it to be seen.
Maybe he was hurt.
I don't think so. Little does he know how famous he is at this point. But not that I would have done anything anyway. But so there have been a lot of benefits for our presence, NATO, the humanitarian efforts, particularly girls' schools. Literacy is up. Girls' schools are open and functioning, but primarily in urban centers where there is some security. So you never know where the pictures are going to happen. I just happened to lean out. It would have taken me about a week to get permission to go into a girls' school through the Ministry of Education, but this is one of the ways you have to work quickly. And this is what Kabul and what Afghans really want, is open markets, chaos, noise, dust, shops open, and to be left alone. It's a little bit more complicated than that, obviously, but this, I think, is a good closing picture to give you an idea of what present-day Kabul is like and what they hope to hold on to. Whether or not we have an influence in that, they certainly hope that Americans stay. There's obviously an argument within the region of South Asia. The Iranians don't want us there. The Russians don't want us there. The Pakistanis are ambivalent about it, but would like us to stay. The Indians want us to stay. So it gets into a lot of areas that I'm going to turn it over to you if you have any questions. But this is present-day Kabul. And if you remember numerous slides backwards, what it did look like, it was rubble. And again, Sorry?
Look at the vehicles and the buildings and so on, and we see nothing of industry or commerce other than people struggling to get through the day. How do you support all this? How that's happening? Is this all because of the countries that have come in?
Essentially, yes.
Look at you've got hundreds of vehicles down there in itself.
You're asking for traffic control?
Who owns them?
Who owns them? Who owns what?
The cars.
They're owned by individuals.
Not just parked there, but people are buying them, right?
Yes, there is an economy.
And there is an economy.
It's opium dependent, but
Now we're getting to the truth of the matter.
Well, it's partially the truth.
All right, continue.
But good idea is to try to get rid of the opium. You're most welcome to take the podium. It's a $200 million a year business for the Taliban. Yes, sir.
At the end of your discussion, you're talking now a little bit about education and the result of it. As I look at this, do the people there relate this shift from rubble to this built-up area in any way to the presence of the Americans?
Yes, they do.
And then early on, I've got a bunch of questions here. You talked about the Uyghurs. They're Turks.
Well, they're Turk. They speak a Turkic language. Yes.
So they're basically another tribe of which.
They're Chinese, Turkey though. They're from China.
China, Turkey, and Afghanistan as well. They overlap, do they?
Well, the Uzbeks speak a Turkish-based language. The Turks have a big role in Central Asia. Well, they're part of the discussion, really.
That's part of my question, yeah.
Yes. I mean, they do have an influence there. The Ottoman Empire was enormous at one point.
So today, our relationship with Turkey is even more vital.
Vital and complex. But they also know how things move around. This is three-dimensional chess you're getting into, and they're a player. They have a seat. And it's important to understand that. I mean, there was a period of I don't care.
But you know,
I'm better than that. Okay. Let's put it that way.
You know it's there.
Yes, yes, absolutely. You'd be very naive if you thought otherwise. But so are people who visit this country.
What about your information that you send back home to your boss? Has all of that been perused and all that by somebody?
Maybe.
Yep.
But it's accurate. That's the best I can do. Make it accurate.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Sir.
The news we get today about from this area is very, very sparse. Now, is that because we don't have people over there who can provide it? Or is it because nobody cares to read it? Over here.
News gathering is expensive. And to maintain a bureau now with a full-time staff person, you have to pay for life insurance. So when Katie Couric or Diane Sawyer used to go over to these places, the insurance kicked in as soon as they closed the airplane door. And she also had a makeup person or handlers and all that stuff. The logistics on the ground is very expensive, even for me. So it's expensive. And is there concern that we're not getting the right information? Definitely. But throughout Kabul and Baghdad periods of news gathering, it takes a toll, and you have to bring in new people willing to go over there and commit. Journalism is not great for domestic tranquility. So, and now we have Brian Williams, who's got his own issue.
God bless him.
But there's certainly the demand is there. The supply is not always so forthcoming. It's difficult to find a volunteer to go to these places willing to stay for 12 months and be paid regularly. Is it sustainable as a profession? It's in flux right now. And what worked for me may not work for the Columbia J School graduate right now. I don't know what the answer is. But the advertisers are essentially the ones who underwrite it. And there's no more advertising in newspapers, or there's less. So how do you monetize the web? It's affected journalism, definitely. And now people have shifted to video. There's a chance they could work in a studio as opposed to going over to Kabul and having that romantic life of Hemingway from the Spanish Civil War or whatever. But a lot of the shine has gone because of lack of support. Please, downstairs, the book is for sale.
That's what the card's on. Is this going to bring that up?
And
you have the card? It's downstairs?
It is an amazingly well-done book. But the publisher took that on. And they came out with beautifully printed, well-bound, and it's a gem, not just because it's mine, but it's hard to get publishers now to...
Who's your publisher?
Prestel. They're a German from Munich.
The pictures are wonderful.
Thank you.
Could I ask you one question?
One.
Okay. The president of Roger Williams College, wife, set up where they would bring Afghan women to this country, and what's that? What became of a couple of those women? They all executed when they go back?
No, I think Babson College also did that. The president of Babson in outside of Boston. They're trained for a year, and generally go back.
Are they safe?
They start out really as kids learning about security. Certainly, it's tenuous. Particularly if they have a high profile. They have to moderate that in their appearance and how they project themselves. It's difficult, but it's improving slowly.
Where would the opportunities come for them as they go back? They're certainly in contrast to the rest of the population.
Well, they're 50% of the population.
Yeah, and what's the other 49.9s on out?
Well, you have traditions of arranged marriages. It's a little bit more complicated than the freedoms we take for granted here. They are still very respectful of family traditions. But generally, if a woman is able to go and get her master somewhere, the father has signed off. And for the betterment of the family, they hope. Because the past they don't want to remember. They live for the present in hopes that their future will be better. But without security, it's difficult. But read whatever you can. There's a very interesting website called the Long War Journal. It monitors the whole thing with Al-Qaeda and ISIS now in the Middle East and Afghanistan. You have to go on the web. It's not reported by anybody coming from Kabul necessarily of known stature. There won't be many Pulitzer Prizes as before for foreign reporting. The emphasis is now on doing things from a distance.
What is the name of that again, please?
Long War Journal.
Thank you.
Just one of many public...
Who wrote it?
Well, Bill Reggio writes it every day. But it gives you a more precise insight into what's going on out there. And it's just information that you don't get now in newspapers. And that's how the web has taken over.
Mm. Now, question for you. Now, you said about the actual journalists, it's sort of they're doing it from a distance. What do you do for photography now? How, I mean, people shoot video, yes, it gets online, but how do you get the day-to-day shots if you don't have
them? You have to train local. AP, Reuters, photographers.
So they actually do have
offices. Yes. But it's rare that a foreigner goes in. Kidnapping is, security is an issue right now. And in corporate security, they're risk averse. It's another issue that we could spend time on. Are we risk averse as a country? Or that's one other topic that you can get from this. But you have to be willing to gamble. And if you gamble, you should be educated about the place you're going into, not in 2 years. It takes 5 years, 6 years, 7 years posting in these places to figure it out.
That's why the British had an empire in India.
Yes, and look what happened.
Yeah. It still didn't.
Right.
Ladies and gentlemen, anybody have any last minute questions? Oh.
Where did you grow up, and at what age did you seem to get a wanderlust to live in places that no one would want to live in?
in 30 seconds.
Sounds like something my father would ask me. What did we do? I started out in Latin America. I was very interested in the late 70s. 1980s in Central America is where I went to El Salvador and started working. I was very curious about the 1954 coup in Guatemala. That's what got me intrigued. And I just started reading more, and it's very accessible from Miami Airport, for instance. But I grew up in New Jersey, went to school in Vermont, and decided to live overseas for 25 years. And with Time magazine as institutional support, it was really quite amazing what they did for journalism.
Yeah. Yeah. You lived in the right era to be able to do that.
India was an interesting place. Still is.
Would you go back?
Absolutely. I still go back. It's just harder now to live there on a daily basis. It's about three times more expensive, and hustle and chaos and traffic compared to the hustle, chaos, and traffic from before.
But you're married now.
That's correct.
Your wife is here?
Yes, she is. Indeed, I applaud it all the time.
Other than yourself going wanting to go back, are we finding it harder for more and more people to do the jobs that you've been doing, to go over there and do this because of the issues that are going on? And what you're...
It's a catch-22 thing. How do you become experienced when you can't actually commit to an experience? And you learn through your mistakes. But Sotloff and other people that have been caught on the Turkish border, one mistake is fatal. And that cuts off a profession pretty quickly. And whether or not schools are going to be able to provide that kind of practical experience, no. The thing and the beauty of journalism is that you're just thrown out. You throw yourself out there, and you have to figure it out. Because your boss will say, well, I did, therefore you can.
As you are saying.
So one of the main editors at the New York Times says if you can make it in India as a writer or a photographer, you can make it anywhere.
Who was that, Nickelsberg? Did he say that?
No, he didn't, but somebody underneath him.
It's true.
The English language is there. Indians in that whole region love to hear stories and relate stories. So as a writer and a photographer, it was an amazing place. It still is. But who's going to underwrite this now for journalists that want to travel? And as well as the military, we need language experts, cultural immersion. Bring people here, send people over. But 2 years is not enough time, at least on a deployment. Because you spend 6 months, first 3 months you spend orientating yourself, and the last 3 months you're worried about where you're going to go at the end. So you're really not 100% focused, only for 18 months. And in that, it goes by so fast, you barely have time to figure out what just happened. There's some who are good at it, but to bring in people with a master's degree from Princeton to the State Department to determine policy without ever having set foot out there, it's an issue that I spend all my time in the field. I need to go consult or listen to people like that with that expertise. But the subtleties, that's devil's in the details there, particularly with these big cultural shifts now for Americans to go over to a new place, not just Latin America, Asia. Thank you for coming.